Hey, welcome to Dr. Osborne's Zone. Tonight we're going to be talking all about yeast. Yeast are a normal part of our microbiome. A lot of people think yeast are bad guys, but Candida gets a bad rap because we always hear the term Candida albicans. And although it can be bad, it can absolutely be a problem. It's much like any other microorganism. In small amounts, it's okay. Our GI tracts can harbor them and they live in harmony. But when they overgrow, when they become too big or too populated in our GI tract, our sinus, our vaginal canal, wherever that might be, you can have major consequences of that overgrowth. And so we're going to dive into that tonight. So let's talk about it. Symptoms of yeast overgrowth. Now, yeast are fermenting microorganisms. One of the things they absolutely like to do is they like to take your carbohydrates and digest and eat them and gain their own energy so that they can do their own thing. And so one of the byproducts when they help you digest your food for you is gas and bloating. This is very, very common, and that's because gas formation through that digestion is very common. So this is a super common symptom, especially those of you who've ever heard the term beer belly. Like, what is in beer, right? Aside from gluten, which can cause bloating? The alcohol and the wheat and the carbohydrate in beer can create gas and bloating and can contribute to yeast overgrowth. And this is true of any alcohol because alcohol is an immunosuppression agent. It suppresses immune system function and can allow for the overgrowth of yeast. But gas and bloating, again, very common symptoms. So that beer belly, if you will, right? And then brain fog is another. A lot of people don't realize that yeast can produce different types of toxins, and some of these toxins can slow down our thinking and slow down our ability to think. So another big one is toenail fungus. And I'll show you some pictures of that here in just a minute, because it's a very, very common sign and a lot of people just ignore it. But it's one of those things, if you're developing fungus in the nail beds, you want to take action immediately. Sugar cravings. Sugar cravings are very, very common. Yeast like sugar, as I mentioned earlier, and they will actually hijack your nervous system and your GI tract and message your brain to eat sugar because they want food. Fatigue is very, very common. Yeast are thieves. They'll steal your B vitamins, and so they use them to help themselves, and so they can create problems within your GI tract that will drag you down. Irritability as well. So if you're, you know, high blood sugar, low blood sugar, severe cravings, irritability, mood swings, you're bloated, you're brain foggy, this is probably a sign that you have yeast overgrowth in, predominantly in my experience, when I see people in their GI tracts, yeast overgrowing in their GI tracts. Now, sometimes too, women will get vaginal discharge, very white discharge, and that can be a sign of yeast as well. White film on the tongue, and then mucus in the stool, and kind of almost what looks like little white specks in the stool, that can be a sign of yeast overgrowth as well. So let's look at some of these images here, just pictures, you can kind of get an idea. So this is a severe case. I had somebody come see me a while back on their tongue, heavily, heavily coated. You can see the pooling here in the divots of the tongue, and then you can see the white speckled spot here as well as back here. This was a massive yeast overgrowth in this individual. And then we have here examples of yeast in the nail bed. So you can see the discoloration, the kind of the dark, almost greenish yellow discoloration, and is present pretty much in all of, and you can see here too, a little bit of skin manifestation, that white area there, that's yeast. And so a lot of people get, you know, yeast growing on the skin as well. So there's jock itch would be an example of a type of fungal infection. And then you can see it in the nail beds as well. It's this white discoloration that you can see along the tip, and you can see how it morphs or changes the nail bed growth as well. And then you can see the tips of the finger, the skin peeling and dry. So this is, again, examples physically. So if you've got these things happening to you, if you look at your nails and you're seeing this, or you're seeing this, or your tongue, this is a pretty severe case. Usually most people's tongues look like that on the bottom, not so much this in the middle. This was pretty severe, but you know, most people have this type of a white coating that scrapes off with a tongue scraper. But again, all signs of yeast is a problem. So let's talk about where else yeast can manifest. So I mentioned some of these things already, but a yeast overgrowth, as I showed you, orally in the mouth. Okay, we saw a picture of that. The GI tract, this is again the gas, the bloating, brain fog, sugar craving, all those symptoms predominantly there. Vaginal, you get, again, a white discharge. And then skin as well. Now, one of the things, one of the ways yeast can manifest with skin is it can look like eczema. And so if you've got a history of eczema, this is something else that you should be aware of. That is a possibility that you have a yeast issue. Now, one that is very rarely talked about is this one, the sinus issue. The yeast can be majorly present in the sinus tract. And so you can develop, congestion would be one of the more common symptoms where no matter what time of the year it is, it's not like an allergy congestion where, you know, at hay fever time you've got congestion, or the oak pollen is in, you've got congestion. But this is with yeast, it's always there, it's always on. And so no matter what you do, it's not going away. And so you're always congested. Think you could potentially have that. If you have chronic upper respiratory infections and you keep going back to the doctor and they keep giving you antibiotics, this is one of the problems with misdiagnosis, is that a chronic antibiotic use from the doc, because they think that your upper respiratory infection is yeast. And so what that does is it increases yeast. It increases their strength. Antibiotics, chronic antibiotic use, even single antibiotic use can exacerbate or can cause candida overgrowth. Now, one of the other places in the GI tract, we talked about the gas and the bloating, one of the other places that yeast has been shown to manifest is in the esophagus, which is part of the GI tract, but this can create symptoms of GERD. So I think it's important to mention it, because many people have candidiasis that is basically damaging the esophagus. And so then what happens, you get a doctor that prescribes, you know, PPI, a proton pump inhibitor, which is gonna block your acid production. And one of your protective mechanisms against yeast is, it knocks it out, is acid. Acid prevents, we eat yeast too, and it's oftentimes in our food. And so your acid, your stomach acid, is one of your intestinal barriers that protects you from the yeast that you might be exposed to in your food coming down through the GI tract and colonizing. So oftentimes, the yeast will manifest as GERD, or what feels like GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease in the esophagus. So if you've had, you know, if you've had this diagnosis and you've been on PPIs and you've been on antibiotics and it's still not going away, you know, one of the best things that you could do, and the same thing up here with the sinus, if you've got chronic sinusitis and chronic upper respiratory infections, ask your doctor to culture. It's very important to culture for yeast. And when they do that culture, it's ideal if they wait at least 4 weeks. So hold that culture in the lab for at least 4 weeks. You know, yeast can be very challenging and difficult to culture. And so if you try to culture them in a day or two, you may not see any growth. But if they hold on to that culture, they really, sometimes they'll find yeast start to manifest or grow. So it's very important. Talk to your doctor about the possibility that that could be happening to you, especially if you have been on chronic antibiotics. So let's talk about what causes a yeast overgrowth. You know, let's just roll right into this, right? Antibiotics. And this is what I was talking about earlier. One of the top causes of yeast overgrowth is antibiotic use. And so again, a lot of doctors dispense antibiotics without a second thought, you know, especially the just in cases. I can't stand it when I see this happen just in cases means let's give you the antibiotic just in case. And this is especially true in dental work, that if you've got a heart issue or you've, you're going in for a deep cleaning and maybe you've got some other comorbidities, a lot of times the dentist will say, well, let's give you the antibiotic just in case, right? Or the or you'll go into your GP. How many of you have had this happen to you where you go in your GP, you have some symptoms of what feels kind of like maybe a cold, and they're like, well, let's give you an antibiotic just in case, right? But they don't culture, and they don't run a test to measure to see whether or not you have a bacterial infection. And so the problem is again, that yeast and bacteria have an overgrowth of either one, have a lot of the same symptoms. So again, doctors will say, just in case it is bacterial, let's give this to you. What they should be doing is not this, but they should be testing you. So I think very judicious use of antibiotics. If you're going to take them, it needs to be based on testing. You know, minus a caveat of an emergency situation where you're in a hospital and you have sepsis and they've identified it, and you know you need the antibiotic to save your life. But as a general rule of thumb, antibiotics don't come without cost, and so you should be aware of that. And so you should ask your doctor about testing to make sure, not only testing to make sure it's not bacterial or that it is bacterial, but there's a type of test you can ask for. It's called a culture and sensitivity. And so what they can do is they can culture it out, and if they, let's say they find a bacteria. So if they find a bacteria, the sensitivity part of the test is where they do which medicines, which antibiotics will work. So they take the bacteria growing from you, and then they test it against different medicines to see which ones will work. And that way you avoid taking a potential antibiotic that also that you may have resistance to, or that the bacteria that is infecting you might have resistance to. And in this way, you judiciously choose an antibiotic with your doc that is going to have a greater likelihood of working for you. So again, culture and sensitivity is something that you should ask for. And if they're not finding any bacteria, now you want to think, okay, in that culture, did they culture it for yeast? Because don't just culture it for bacteria, but also culture it for yeast. There was a study published in the Journal of the American Medical Association, I think it was about 15 years ago, and it was in regard to upper respiratory infection and chronic sinusitis. And I think it was, don't quote me on this, it was somewhere in the neighborhood of about 90% of sinusitis infections were not bacterial, they actually were fungal. And so you definitely want to get that cultured to make that determination, because again, antibiotics, if you have a fungal infection, antibiotics make it worse. And if you don't have a fungal infection or yeast infection, antibiotics can cause them. So keep that in mind. And so just to show you here, look at this, a study published in 1966 in the journal Bacteriological Review. And so this is, again, I show you this because it's 1966. And if you look at this, the patients on antibiotics experienced proliferation of Candida albicans in the alimentary canal. This is again in your gut, right? Is no longer a point for dispute. In other words, there's so much scientific evidence that shows that people on antibiotics develop yeast overgrowth in their GI tracts, that there's no longer an argument. We're not arguing about the possibility that that can happen, right? So your doctor should be aware of the research that exists in this regard, and should help you, you know, do this type of testing to help you rule it out. Now, other things that can cause an overgrowth, well, hang on just a minute, let me back up. So it's not always prescription antibiotics that we need to be concerned with. Chlorine, bromine, these are things oftentimes added to drinking water, to the city municipal water supply. These things are antibiotics. And so if you're exposed to large quantities of chlorine and bromine through your drinking water, they act as a natural antibiotic. They can increase your risk for the development of yeast overgrowth. And then also be aware that pesticides are antibiotics, right? In a sense, they're antibiotics. And so if you're not eating organically, if you're eating a lot of non-organic food, you know, then you're basically getting some exposure, and you're having the potential here to disrupt your microbiome, allowing for yeast overgrowth to occur. So don't forget, it's not just prescriptive antibiotics, but it's also other things that we're commonly exposed to. And then we have excessive carbohydrates. Excessive carbohydrates, so yeast thrive on carbs. Yeast, that's what they eat. They love I'm a terrible artist here. Yeast love carbs. They also love sugar. So any type of simple sugars, not just processed sugar either. If you've got a yeast overgrowth and you're heavy on the fruit, that fruit sugar in and of itself can help the yeast propagate as well. Remember how we make wine. We take grape sugar and yeast, right? And the yeast eat the grape sugar and produce wine. And so a lot of people with severe enough GI tract yeast overgrowth will have a wine factory inside of their GI tract. And if you give that yeast, if you give it fruit, you're going to get alcohol even if you don't want it. And that alcohol creates different types of problems, but you know, it's a toxin for the liver as one issue, but alcohol also causes B vitamin deficiency, fatigue, brain fog, and other problems. So it's kind of a vicious cycle. Once that yeast is there, if you keep feeding it, you're going to keep getting this even if you don't drink. So that's true of excessive carbohydrates, also true of processed sugar. So if you suspect that you have a yeast overgrowth, and maybe you're visiting your doctor and you're getting treated and you're on, you know, one of the azole antifungals, one of the medications, like there's multitudes of different drugs that doctors will prescribe to treat a fungal infection. But if you're being treated, it's important to change your diet too at the same time. And the way you would want to change your diet is you would want to keep your carbs below 33% of your total caloric intake, and you'd want to eliminate any kind of processed sugar and really limit your intake of fruit. What I do is I like to limit people's intake of fruit to about, you know, 1.5 cups total per day. And really the type of fruit that you would want to consume in this case is lower glycemic fruit, so fruit that really has a lower sugar content. And so an example of that would be berries are much lower sugar fructose content than are something like let's say a banana or say grapes. So you really want to, again, we're trying to starve them out. That's one of the elements to helping your body get balance back, is to not feed that yeast beast as your doctor's trying to give you a drug to treat it.